Hi, it's Jessica DaMassa with WTF Health. I'm here at the HISA studio at HIC 2019, and joining me right now, I have Matiu Bush. He is the Deputy Director of the Health Transformation Lab at RMIT, and also the founder of One Good Street. So we are going to have a little chat here about aging in place, loneliness, and then something that I've never even heard of before called cybernetics. And so you have to stay tuned for that because it's the end of this conversation. So talk to me first, though, about One Good Street and the idea behind this and why it's so important in terms of helping people age in place.
So I look after a 84-year-old retired GP on my street.
Okay.
He lives in a few doors up. And when he falls out of bed, his daughter calls me. This can be 4 a.m. And
oh
I go
goodness.
And pick him up, put him back into bed. And that act of neighbour-initiated care saves an ambulance fee. So that's usually, in Australian dollars, about $800.
Oh my gosh, okay.
A trip to the emergency department if he doesn't need it, that's probably saving around $2,000. So my act of doing that saves roughly, I think, about $3,000. And when I talk about that, we hear other stories about neighbour-initiated
yeah.
care. And I do it with joy, and others do it with joy, because it's part of our social capital.
Mm-hmm.
It's how we make our streets better places to live. So when I saw this level of activity, I realised there was untapped potential in neighbour-initiated care.
Right.
And that there is a community safety net that can hold people. Hold people when services finish. Hold people when community nurses finish work. It's the neighbours that make things happen. And we really deserve a place, the neighbourhoods deserve a place in the care marketplace, on the table, talking about discharge, talking about when people are being discharged to hospital and how we can care for them, because there is untapped potential. So I decided to set up this charity, One Good Street, and
okay.
it's all about neighbour-initiated care to reduce isolation and loneliness.
Mm-hmm.
People who are lonely are 27% increased chance of death. It really does affect the amount of times they attend the GP, but
Absolutely.
Also the emergency department. So by looking after our older people in the community, our seniors, with a focus on connection, we actually improve the front door operation of the emergency department.
I would imagine, too, you're helping people, you're helping mitigate situations that could become very costly and very dangerous for these seniors by intervening early. Just like on the off remark when you're having coffee with someone in the morning, like, oh, you know, I'm really not feeling very well. Well, maybe we should check that out rather than 4 or 5 days later when things have escalated. That's phenomenal. So neighbor-induced care, I love this. And I feel like one of the things that's really inspiring about what you've managed to build with One Good Street is the fact that you've managed to kind of quantify these acts of kindness. So share with me some of the numbers, both in terms of, you talked a little bit about cost savings, but also in the impact that you're having.
Absolutely. So we are live in four suburbs or four parts of Melbourne.
Mm-hmm.
We've got over 800 members on our Facebook group, and that's where we run it from.
Sure.
And what we do is we accredit the streets that are where somebody who lives in that street is a member of One Good Street. So we're able to see on a map which are the best streets to age in. So we've got roughly, it's about 30 to 40 streets that are accredited as being the best streets to be older in. And
okay.
we can go to council, to government, and say this is a great place to live, especially if you're 85, because there's enough social capital here to support them. When you talked about just briefly
sure.
about the upstreaming and preventative care, we run aircon clubs. So when it's hot, you open up your house and you invite older people in to enjoy the air conditioning, because older people who are pensioners or who don't have a lot of money are really concerned about using the electricity for aircon, etc. And we know that older people deteriorate in the heat and end up being unwell or dying, and this is all preventable.
And it's so simple too.
If we open
I mean, it's
up
such
homes.
A simple,
yes.
simple solution to mitigate a lot of problems. I wanted to interject and ask
yes.
real quick about that accreditation process.
Yes.
So, what are some of the criteria for accreditation of a block, and then like how does that process work?
Yeah, indeed. So we, if you join the Facebook group, you start to receive a lot of curated content from us.
Okay.
So you start to learn more about dementia, more about dying at home, living, aging in place. You start to learn about these things because we are seeding that through on our Facebook feed. And then if you decide to join up, you can get involved in a range of activities. So we do cycling without age, which is taking older people out for bike rides.
Oh, that's awesome.
It also acknowledges that you're probably already doing stuff. So you actually potentially don't have to do a single thing more because you're actually a caring person on your street. You're already a street champion. So but just by joining and getting interested, that's where we accredit the street. And it's also bringing in elements of nudge theory, of cognitive psychology. When people are rewarded
yeah.
for good and then they see that their streets change colour. And then when the auctioneer is talking about that street, saying you want to live on this street because this street's a good street, it's been accredited as being a caring street, the social capital is really thick here. It has a economic value as well. So we've made that visual, the economic value of having social capital in your neighbourhood because you're caring. And the other thing we've done is we've realised there was really strong currents of urban renewal, of recycling, of protecting our planet, of climate action and climate change. And what we've done is we've created what I call the coincidence of wants. So a coincidence of wants is you want to live in a great neighbourhood, you want to do great things for the environment. We've stretched that to also mean you want to do great things for older people. You want to reduce isolation and loneliness. And we've done that because if you've got passion and energy to compost, if you've got passion and energy to conserve your lights and reduce your carbon footprint, you've also got energy to help older people.
All right, one of the things, and I rarely do this, but I want to talk about your presentation on stage at HIC here. And one of the things that you said that stuck with me, just because I wanted to ask a follow-up question, was you were talking about some of the pushback you were actually getting, though, about the risk that you're taking on. And I believe your comment back was, fuck risk. So tell me, what kind of risk are people thinking that you're putting these seniors at, or the people taking care of them? And I mean, truly, and please elaborate on fuck risk. I'd like to hear more about that.
Hashtag fuck risk.
Exactly.
it highlights that in healthcare, we have become obsessed with risk.
Yeah.
And in doing so, we have stifled creativity.
Absolutely.
There is a role for a very legitimate role for ensuring safety and standardization and management of risk, absolutely. But often those individuals come and put a full stop on things. Mm-hmm. So for example, often when I present, people say, what about the risk to the older person about being surrounded by volunteers that could take advantage of them? And it is really, in 2019, we can solve that problem. We can do police checks, we can do interviews without making it too burdensome so that people can be put in contact with a range of individuals. One of the paradoxes is the more people in your life, the less likely you are to experience elder abuse.
Right.
Elder abuse happens in isolation with small numbers of people. So by flooding your life with meaningful contacts from diverse backgrounds, they're going to see things.
And these are your neighbors. It's not like these are complete strangers. They live next door.
Correct. So that protective element.
Right.
Now, it is human nature to focus on the worst case scenario, but we're bringing that back. We found this often with people that were wanted to donate equipment to us.
Okay.
And so when someone said, I've got a scooter, I've got an electric wheelchair, or I've got a whole lot of supplies, dressing supplies, and hospitals said, don't touch it. Infection control risk, etc. Even though the evidence actually says an unopened packet of equipment in a house is no risk.
Right.
But all of that goes into bin, all of that goes into landfill.
Which is crazy.
It is crazy.
Especially when there are people who need it.
Well, there are people who can't afford it. And
right.
When you're funded by the government, you have to make the cruel math is, do I have a shower or do I have my house cleaned or do I save for a piece of equipment? That's what we're putting seniors through. So that's why we established the Library of Aged Care Things. It is a free lending library, so it's almost like a gum tree for aged care equipment.
Okay.
And people don't want money for it. They want to see it go on. And one of the things that when people donate equipment to me, they say, let me tell you about this equipment. So there's a narrative embedded in there.
And I'm sure it helps with the grieving process if there is one that's attached to that, yeah.
So often when I drive off with a van full of electric bed and a wheelchair and commodes and all these supplies, I remember one woman saying to me, goodbye, Mum and Dad.
Oh, my God, that's heartbreaking.
That was the last remnants. It also helps them to reminisce, because what I do is when I deliver the equipment to older people who need it, I take, with their consent, take a photo, send it back to them and say, look where your donation's gone. And then they can reminisce and see the spirit of their loved one living on through generosity. So it is incredibly therapeutic.
Well, I'm glad that you've decided to take your hashtag fuck risk approach on that. Okay, I want to transition to this. How do you pronounce it again? Cybernetics?
Cybernetics.
Cybernetics. I don't want to mispronounce that. What is this? I mean, that was a term I have never come across before. So tell me what that is. And this is something you're doing at RMIT, which is a university here in Australia. A very prestigious one.
Great. So cybernetics has been around since the 1940s. Mm-hmm. And it was post-World War II where there was a lot of new technology.
Okay.
So a lot of professors in the US and in the Europe and the UK came together and said, what framework, what theoretical framework do we need to start working on to manage? And they, in 1942, they were talking about artificial intelligence, machine learning. They were imagining supercomputers. So what they did was drew a circle around a whole lot of disciplines, including human-centered design, service design, computational theory, ethics, logic, epistemology, anthropology, engineering, mathematics, physics. They drew this
everything
cognitive psychology, because they knew that there would be this interplay between the human and the machine.
Right.
So ultimately, cybernetics is this correlation, or what happens between a human, the machine, and society, and all the communication that is involved in that, all of the feedback that's involved in that, to heading towards goals. So it fits perfectly in health, because we have specific goals in health. And so cybernetics for us is this fantastic framework in which to tackle health's biggest problems.
Okay, so how are you going to be applying that? I know you're relatively new in your position there at RMIT, so what is the first thing you're going to do with this? Are you looking at aging?
Absolute loneliness and isolation. A good example is looking at what is it like to have off-planet healthcare. So which conditions...
Outer space.
Some conditions will do better in zero gravity. We know nanoparticles evolve differently in outer space, so we potentially can produce pharmaceuticals or medical devices off-planet, bring it down for on-planet care. We're talking about looking very differently at problems. So for example, if someone came to us and said Indigenous health, we would look at it in regards to how do we look at privilege and racism as a virus?
Okay.
How do we have an immunological response to racism and also to privilege, which excludes others? So it's a very different take.
That's
on...
That's interesting.
Yeah, well, it's because we've been marinating in these problems for so long, and it's time to look completely differently at them in order to get new solutions. And that's where that creativity comes in. Often... people talk to me and say, you know, what do we need more in healthcare? Is it leadership? Well, some component. I think we're bereft of creativity and creative solutions. And the lab is co-funded by Cisco, which gives us a tremendous opportunity to really explore a range of topics that looks at the technology, but also the humanity, so that we reduce that false dichotomy that tech's going to save, or tech is this malignant prophecy and it's going to destroy everything in our world, or that it's all just tactile and it should all be human. So we're starting those conversations and provocations about this sectors in healthcare, the sector's fetishization of technology.
Absolutely.
They're obsessed. They think it's going to deliver so much more. Then other people are worried that we're going to lose control. We're always in control. For us at the Health Transformation Lab, we see technology as the paintbrush and the human as the artist. Together, we'll create something beautiful.
I love this. I cannot wait to hear more about your work there. Congratulations on that new position. Look forward to seeing what comes out of it. Thank you so much also for sharing your story about One Good Street. I love hearing about that as well. Thank you. I'm Jessica DaMassa here with WTF Health at HISA's studio at HIC 2019. Thank you so much for joining us.